Hello again, everyone, and thanks so much for joining us for this Sunday's edition of Alaska Weather. I'm Dave Percy, a meteorologist with the National Weather Service, and I'll be hosting today's show. Up first on the hazardous weather graphic, well, no warnings, watches, or advisories out for interior Alaska, southern half of the state, the Panhandle, Aleutians out west, but up to the north, there's a winter storm warning out for the, looks like the eastern north slope here on up into the north side of the Brooks Range, and that's for midnight, or that it begins at midnight tonight and lasts until 6 or 7 o'clock tomorrow morning. And that's for anywhere from 4 to 8 inches of snow that could fall, with a cold upper trough coming southward from the Arctic. And definitely the temperatures, some areas already near freezing mid-afternoon today throughout the Brooks Range. So that's where the heaviest snow will be. Of course, the higher elevations, there'll be kind of more of a mixed condition here along the coastal areas, or maybe real wet slop type of stuff, but look for the 4 to 8 inches is with any elevation at all. And nothing out west. Fire danger kind of spread around a little bit today, returned here in the Copper River Basin due to some breezy conditions, continued dry, and that was had temperatures in the lower 60s, but increase in the breeze kicked it up from what it was yesterday here as far as the fire danger went, but nothing extreme. Also in the north side of the Alaska Range there, over toward Northway Tok, maybe Delta, and also in a little more extensive area in the greater Fairbanks area around there in the Tanawha Valley, and also mostly north of the Yukon River there, from north side of the Yukon River up in the Yukon Flats, and another area of enhanced fire danger over the Koyukuk Valley, and down here, kind of over the southern Kobuk Valley or so. Otherwise, looking pretty good. And looks like, of course, cold air and moisture will be probably knocking these out here tonight and tomorrow. And for the satellite imagery, see, we had one system moving off to the southeast here. So the southeast coast today had partly mostly sunny skies, temperatures in many locations running 65 to 70 degrees. One of the warmer locations on the Haines Highway by some bridge, they had 71 degrees this afternoon at 3 p.m. and some sunshine all the way up into the eastern interior there. And then this system heading eastward, the next one, bringing some fair amounts of rain, but moving fast enough that it's not creating any serious amounts of rain. Nothing, 12-hour amounts today were generally anywhere from a quarter to maybe 3/4 of an inch, with Kenai picking up 2/3 of an inch today there, and other areas of the Seward Peninsula. So another soaking rain there for the peninsula. And otherwise back to the west here, Aniak had roughly 4/10 of an inch, Seward 1/2 inch of rain, and McGrath had about 1/4 of an inch of precipitation today. And that's moving eastward here. Front brought about roughly 2/10 of an inch to Kodiak. That's since ended, westerly flow now. So dry conditions there. Even the showers are about over in that area. And also drying out here back to the west. Not a lot of moisture, clouds though, but showers kind of scattered in nature, isolated. A little more extensive light precipitation back up here to the northwest, St. Lawrence Island. And this system tracking eastward, and also the upper system a little farther to the south and surface, well, that's going to start shifting southeast, so the front's going to slow down as it moves in toward the southeast coast a little bit tonight. Still kick the winds up. Next cloud mass here with the storm system that's south of the western Aleutians, already spreading moisture up into the far western Aleutians, mostly from Kiska Island out towards Shimia, and main rain-producing clouds from those areas back to the southwest. It's just higher stuff spreading eastward toward Adak and Atka. And on the chart today, here's a surface low, roughly over the Susitna Valley, give or take, kind of a flat gradient here. Probably could draw several low centers in here, even up kind of a thermal low up there on the lee side of the Alaska Range. But I picked that spot, 996 millibars, And again, fair amounts of rain with this, and also winds head of the front kicking up to 35, 40 miles an hour at Portage, Glacier, and McHugh Creek. And that's not really a notable wind for either of those locations, but it did pick it up in some areas here. And also west winds, northwest winds, coming across the Alaska Peninsula with this trough. It gets up to 35 to 40 miles an hour, with Cold Bay receiving the highest wind gusts today. And a little bit of moisture, as I said, now working its way, trying to push in toward the Central Aleutians, probably this evening before it gets there. And then higher pressure back to the west, really just not so much a strong high. 1,025 millibars, I guess that's good enough, that qualifies. Anyway, we're looking at some clearing here spreading into the Pribilofs. May have seen a few sun breaks this afternoon, possibly at St. George or St. Paul. Weak trough up here, areas of light precipitation, and that's going to increase tonight. And again, with that winter storm warning out up there for 48 inches of snow, it'll be mostly mixed along the coastal areas, lower elevations. As soon as you get any elevation, it'll be in the form of snow. But south of the mountains, dry, still maybe some clearing here through the interior, but maybe some isolated showers, Shishmaref, maybe to Tin City, and this kind of a weak feature here could trigger a few scattered isolated showers that'll extend from the 40 mile country, upper Tanawha Valley, all the way back across the northern Kuskokwim Valley, on out to the southwest coast, Nunavak Island, chance of showers, and wind slowly diminishing here, the Alaska Peninsula, and the moisture I have drawn in there, mostly upslope. Scattered showers or drizzle, real light at best here due to the interaction of the terrain with the moisture point coming in off the Bering Sea. Better rainfall coming into the Central Aleutians with increasing wind, especially on the back side of this feature, a little bit tighter gradient, but winds will also be kicking up with this for tonight into the Central Aleutians. And clouds increase here over the southeast coast with rain developing along the north coast from Port Alexander up to Elfin Cove, and should stay mostly west of Juneau through the night tonight, but look for periods of rain along the North Gulf Coast. Winds increasing Kodiak Island tonight, could see gusts 40 miles an hour later on, mostly down towards Sitkanak, Akiak, and those areas. And then for tomorrow, that system shifts eastward and begins to take a shift to the east and southeast. It'll be in sliding a little bit farther to the southeast there, so that's going to make for a slow frontal progression in the southeast wind flow here. So periods of rain, Dixon entrance of the Queen Charlotte's all the way up to Lincoln Isle Glacier Bay, be pretty light from Haines on up to Skagway, getting right on the edge there. Northerly flow, north-northwest flow here as this pulls off to the east. Sunshine, Kodiak Island, partly to mostly sunny, becoming partly to mostly sunny in the afternoon here for South Central Alaska, Prince William Sound, and even back into the Kuskokwim Valley and the lower Yukon and Kuskokwim Valley areas to the deltas. Could see some afternoon clearing, isolated showers, and then the mess up to the north there, mostly from the Brooks Range on out, depending on your elevation and time of day and location. It'll be rain or snow or a mixture of both, so I just put a mixture up there. And then this system in the Bering Sea, or actually tracking eastward, we've got the center near Adak, triple point front pushing in across the eastern Aleutians, so it looks like periods of rain tomorrow afternoon into the Alaska Peninsula tomorrow afternoon, probably starting around midday or sooner for the eastern Aleutians, and also conditions, ceilings, visibilities coming down, trending toward rain for the Pribilofs in the afternoon, but not too bad, just mostly cloudy here for the northern Bering Sea with pretty light winds here, much lighter winds for the Alaska Peninsula. And for Tuesday, still, mixture of precipitation possible up there, pretty likely actually for the Arctic coast to the Brooks Range. Milder, so rain showers or rain up here with the northeast interior. Scattered showers, Tanawha Valley into the eastern Copper River Basin area, Wrangell Mountains, but dry, South Central Alaska. Increasing clouds here for Cook Inlet, Kenai Peninsula, Kuskokwim Valley with possibly moderate rainfall amounts coming in from Kodiak Island up into northeast Bristol Bay. And wet and windy for the central eastern Aleutians, although improving late for Adak and Atka. A little bit higher pressure out west. And dry for the Panhandle. I like to call it partly sunny. No rainfall, winds light, and temperatures 50s to maybe 60. Lows tonight down that way, upper 40s. Otherwise, mid-30s here for the eastern interior. Down to 30 there, Anituvik and Arctic Village. mid-30s here for the Arctic coast, mid to upper 30s actually, and upper 40s to near 50 out to the southwest and the Aleutians and Bering Sea. Highs for tomorrow, 55 to 62 south central Alaska, 60 to 65 Bristol Bay, in the upper 40s to mid 50s interior Alaska, up to upper 30s to mid 40s there in the Brooks Range. So snowfall level about 2,000 feet there tomorrow and tomorrow afternoon. Anyway, mid 50s for the Panhandle. Lows the following morning. A little chillier down into the upper 20s for the Brooks Range, mid 30s near freezing Arctic coast, upper 40s southwest coast, followed by highs 50s and 60s.
And now, aviation weather around Alaska.
Moving on to aviation, marginal VFR and across the Panhandle, IFR right along the coastline for Monday morning. IFR here along and south of the Alaska Range and back to the west, and then across Kuskokwim Valley and Yukon-Kuskokwim Delta, Nunavak Island to the Pribilofs, IFR North Slope, on out to the Arctic coast there, say from Old Wainwright on over. And VFR here, North Central Interior, from actually Norton Sound all the way into Canada, and big area IFR out over the western Bering and Aleutians, just west of Nikulski. And for the afternoon, that advances eastward there across Unalaska Island, extending all the way back, southern Bering Sea, mostly IFR, northern Bering Sea, mostly marginal of the Seward Peninsula, IFR, Yukon-Kuskokwim Delta, right on down to Cape Newenam, and then eastward here, at Pilot Point, Port Hyden along the Alaska Peninsula there. Northwest flow here means VFR south side, Kodiak Island, VFR, and becoming VFR here into Cook Inlet, Kenai Peninsula, Prince William Sound. Matanuska is to sit in the valley, improving the Copper River Basin. Marginal VFR over areas of the interior and IFR along the southeast coast, as well as over the southern areas. And then for Tuesday morning, that improves. Just some marginal VFR there, Prince of Wales Island, otherwise VFR, right on up to Yakutat. And looks like northern Copper River Basin up the east side of the state there, an area IFR right on to the Arctic coast. Marginal VFR improving a little bit here, especially up here with the Northwest Seward Peninsula VFR. And some IFR still lingering from the Western Alaska Range westward to the Kuskokwim Bay, Nunavak Island, Aleutians, Alaska Peninsula, on out to the west. And for the afternoon, not much change here. Central Southern Bering Sea and Aleutians, as well as the Aleutians, mostly IFR. And IFR back in across Kodiak Island and Bristol Bay into the southern Kuskokwim Valley and Kuskokwim Delta. Otherwise, looks like VFR here, Cook Inlet, Kenai Peninsula, holding through Tuesday afternoon back to the northwest across Norton Sound to Kotzebue Sound. And probably the Kobuk Valley, IFR, Eastern North Slope and Arctic Coast, IFR here, Eastern North Gulf Coast, and VFR for the Panhandle. And it looks like some VFR there also from, say, near or just south of Eagle, southward to Chicken. And for your passes tomorrow, Anituvik looks IFR throughout most of the day at times. Should be better over toward Adigan, thinning out the moisture a little bit there, but still marginal VFR occasionally throughout the day Monday. And for Lake Clark and Merrill, looks like a marginal kind of VFR day, or a marginal VFR kind of day for that pass. Same thing for Rainy, marginal VFR. Windy starting out IFR, becoming marginal. And Isabel, same trend, starting out with IFR, trending toward marginal in the afternoon. Mintasta, occasionally marginal, possibly becoming, yeah, marginal VFR for Mintasta the entire day. Tanita, though, marginal VFR, will become VFR in the afternoon, or maybe by noon or late morning. And for Portage, marginal VFR, westerly flow becoming VFR, and Chilkoot and White looks marginal. And for the, let's see, freezing level chart here, at the surface, colder air coming down. Here's what you got at the surface, mostly on the up toward the Brooks Range here with any elevation at all, dropping near or below freezing, 2,000 feet there, trying to get south of the Brooks Range and 6,000 through the central interior. And also up here along the North Gulf Coast down to Kodiak Island, 6,000 foot freezing levels here in toward the southeast coast. And still 12,000 feet here over the eastern Aleutians. It's kind of shifting eastward now, that warmer air aloft, and sagging southward a little bit here as the northerly flow begins to take over and 8 to 10,000 feet over the Bering Sea. As far as icing goes, areas of considerable moderate rim icing above 10,000 feet with the next system coming eastward here to the eastern Aleutians, spreading into the Pribilofs late. Some leftover icing up here over the Koyukuk Valley on up to the central north slope. And then with that front pushing into the Panhandle, icing occasionally moderate there above 7,000. Jet stream, northerly flow, here's a cold upper low coming southward. The one moving into the Panhandle, 9,000 feet, 40 to 55 knots across Kodiak Island. 30 to 40 knot winds into the Panhandle and 60 knotters over the Aleutians, jumping into turbulence, moderate chop here in Kodiak Island, areas of the Aleutians up along the Seward Peninsula and the Panhandle.
So my heart is definitely racing. I don't know about anyone else's. This is the stuff nerds dream of.
10 seconds. 9, 8, 7, 6.
It's gonna
happen. 5, 4, 3.
That countdown you just heard? We'll get back to that in a minute. Last episode, we saw the epic launch of ISAT-2, NASA's newest state-of-the-art ice-observing satellite. But now that that's in orbit, the pressure to deliver results is on.
Between launch and, you know, the first ground returns, you know, it took 17, 18 days or something like this. You know, it's a time when you're quite nervous.
9 years ago, Dr. Torsten Marcus took over as the lead project scientist for ISAT-2 during a time when the mission needed a champion.
You start fighting for a mission over, you know, for 9 years now.
So when ISAT-2 was turned on for the first time 18 days after it was launched, only then would the science team know if the whole thing had worked. And it did. If it sounds like there's a lot of noise in the background, that's because Torsten is being interviewed from a plane 1,500 feet in the air. IceBridge was tasked with the job of bridging the data between the end of ISAT's mission and the beginning of ISAT-2, about a 9-year difference.
The goal is that it would run until ISAT-2 launched and then would have overlap with ISAT-2 as well, so we can get a really long, well-calibrated time series from IceBridge.
As the deputy project scientist for Operation IceBridge, Brick works closely with Torsten to make sure the two missions are syncing up.
The timing was everything during that mission, which was a real challenge because not only do we need to...
Basically, what you need to take away is getting an airplane and a satellite in space to fly over the same flight path at the same time and collect matching data is really, really hard. IceBridge was tasked with two objectives: check the accuracy of ISAT-2's data over land ice and over sea ice. They were able to lock in the land ice data fairly quickly in the mission, but the sea ice data...
It was really tricky. We waited day after day. Do we fly the sea ice? It's still on our list.
7, 6.
It's gonna
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Mark on the overpass, 04, 35, 35 Zulu.
Here's what just happened. A plane 1,500 feet up and a satellite 308 miles up measured the same sea ice at the same time. This moment finally linked veteran mission Operation IceBridge's data to that of its new sister mission, ISAT-2. Two projects that, until now, were separate for nearly 10 years.
It's a very satisfying feeling because you do something that is meaningful and in the bigger picture. And yeah, that's very satisfying.
Our search for knowledge doesn't end here. GRACE Follow-On and ISAT-2, the two satellite missions that launched this year, will continue to bring in incredible data for the foreseeable future. The steady drumbeat of campaigns in the field goes on, but most of all, the people who look for answers will never stop searching. And from our perspective, it's pretty clear why.
My favorite planet is the planet Earth.
What? Earth? Really?
The Earth, obviously.
By favorite planet in the solar system? Earth, right? We live on it. It's a really important one.
Favorite planet is Earth.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
what?
When you look out at the other planets, they're absolutely fascinating. They've got all sorts of interesting systems going on. They've got dust storms. But then when you're on another planet, looking back at Earth, I mean, it's just incredible.
Whenever you go in different places, it looks so different, so amazing. It's just, I love the planet Earth. It's just a very special planet. This is our home.
We've seen things far beyond the solar system. But even with all that, even the amazing things we've seen, one of the most amazing is the Earth itself.
It's got to be Earth. It's got to be Earth.
It's got to be here. I like the polar regions of here, of Earth. Yeah,
yeah,
sorry. It's very boring.
Earth is good.
Earth is good.
We live here, it sustains our life.
I'm not going to turn my back on it.
It's got water, it's got ice, it's got vegetation. I mean, it's just, it's rich with life. And so studying Earth is a very, very rewarding career. And I think if we were on any other planet, we would be trying to get to Earth as quickly as we could.
And now, marine weather around Alaska.
Welcome back. Looking at today's sea ice analysis, starting to grow a little bit. Some new ice starting to show up now along the outer ice edge, and had this area now show up down here. Probably got some clearing and could see it was there as opposed to just forming in place. It wasn't on the previous map. But anyway, it looks like starting to form a little bit, new ice with the colder air coming down across that area. And over the next 4 or 5 days, kind of oscillating around depending on really which way the wind blows. And for the coastal water forecast, gale warnings tomorrow, 35 knots southeasterlies along the outer coastline, east 40 knots on the extreme north coast. And otherwise, lighter winds here, north of the Lynn Canal, north of 10. 15 knots for Stevens Passage out of the north, 2 to 3 foot seas there. Small craft advisories for Clarence Strait, southeast 25, 6 foot seas. And the outlook for Tuesday, lighter winds here along the coast, but still small craft advisories, especially the south coast, 25 knot winds out of the east and then becoming north 25 here, say Port Alexander to Sitka, and then on up the coastline, turning northwest at 20 to west at 20 up there near Yakutat. Whoop, I forgot the inside waters. Inside waters, Lynn Canal, 15 knots out of the north, northeast 15 for Passage Canal, and Clarence Strait, north 15, with 5 foot seas, otherwise 2 to 3 feet for the remainder of the area. And for Prince William Sound, tomorrow, northwest winds, winds becoming northwest at 20 knots, seas at about 3 feet. Gales here for the eastern north Gulf Coast, east northeast, 35 knots, 12 foot seas, north winds at 30. For the western North Gulf Coast, small craft advisories for the Barrens, northwest 30 knots, 9 foot seas. Kamishak Bay, pretty brisk winds out of the west coming through Kamishak Gap, 30 knots there, 7 foot seas. And Cook Inlet, northwest at 10, seas 2 feet or less. And for Tuesday, northeast 10 knots, 1 foot seas north of the Forelands here, southern Cook Inlet, northeast 15, and then small craft advisories, Kamishak Bay, northwest 25, west 25, 7 foot seas for the Barrens. And west-southwest of 15 for the North Gulf Coast with 6 to 7 foot seas, north 15, seas 2 feet, Prince William Sound. Kodiak Island, gales tomorrow, west-northwest 35 to 40 knots, probably some higher gusts as well, and seas running 8 to 12 feet, and gale warnings for northwest winds at 35 from Sitkanak on down the coast to Castle Cape and Alaska Peninsula, northwest 20 to 30 knots, strongest south or on the Pacific side of the peninsula. Bristol Bay, northwest 30 knots, seas 9 feet. For Tuesday, southeast 15 there for the bay with 3-foot seas and small craft advisories for the Alaska Peninsula. North side here, we've got 25 knots out of the south. South side, actually Cape Sarachef all the way up to Sitkanak. Southwest 30 knots, seas 9 to 10 feet. Southwest 25 up the east side of Kodiak, Shelikof Strait, 20 knots with 4-foot seas. Eastern Aleutians, south to southeast, 20 to 25 knots and 30 knot winds here, or 25 to 30 knot winds from the south southeast central Aleutians. Big increase here, northwest 40, so gales west of Adak all the way to Shimianat too. And then for Tuesday, drops off to about 20 knots for the far western Aleutians, but we got gales from Amchitka Island turning westerly at 35 across Adak and Atka, Fox Islands south to southwest at 30. And for the southwest coast, we've got northwest winds in the forecast tomorrow, 20 to 25 knots, strongest south of Nunavak Island, east 20 for the Pribilofs, north 25 St. Lawrence Island, and those will turn northeast at the same speed on Tuesday, northeast 30 north of Nunavak Island, across St. Matthew Island, east 25 for the out of Kuskokwim Bay, and southeast 20 for the Pribilofs. Arctic coast, small craft advisories on the east side there, 25 knot winds, otherwise northeast 20 here. And you get to Point Lay on down to the Bering Strait, 25 knots from the northeast becoming north south of Cape Thompson. Outlook for Tuesday, whales to Cape Thompson, north 20 knots, lighter winds coming around the capes, 10 knots on the west side, and east-northeast 15 for the central eastern Beaufort Sea coast, seas running about 3 feet. For tonight again, winter storm warning, midnight to 6 or 7 a.m. here for the eastern north slope on up to the Brooks Range, 48 inches of snow, heaviest the highest amounts, higher elevations, dry south of the mountains, and then this trough kicking off a few showers, rain spreading eastward, wet along the North Gulf Coast, ending Cook Inlet, spreading into the Panhandle. For tomorrow, it'll be a wet day there for the Panhandle, those gale force winds, next system coming in to the Aleutians and Pribilofs, and that'll push rain into the southwest interior from Kodiak to the Yukon Delta on Tuesday afternoon.
These forecasts are for planning purposes only. Call 1-800-WX-BRIEF for a formal pre-flight briefing. Always file a flight plan before you go flying. The U.S. Coast Guard Auxiliary urges you to leave a float plan with a friend or the harbormaster before you go boating.